In the past few videos, I've talked about how the tensor product works and how it behaves, but I haven't really formally defined it. So in this video, I'm going to formally define what the tensor product is and also introduce the idea of tensor product spaces. Also, be warned that I'm using non-standard notation for the tensor product. Your textbooks will write it like this with the circle times symbol. I'm going to leave that symbol out and write the tensor product like this. So in previous videos, I've shown how combining a vector and a covector together using the tensor product can give us a linear map. And the coefficients of this linear map are really just the entries of an array given by the Kronecker product of the column vector representing the vector and the row vector representing the covector. We also showed that combining two covectors using the tensor product can give us a bilinear form, whose coefficients are really just the entries of the array given by the Kronecker product of the two row vectors associated with these covectors. So in this video, we're finally going to properly define what the tensor product operation is. So recall, all of this tensor product stuff started off with the suggestion of doing array multiplication with a column on the left and a row on the right. Now consider what happens if we scale this by some number n. Well, that's the same thing as scaling the column by n or scaling the row by n. In both cases, we get the same result, which is this matrix up here. Likewise, when we have the tensor product between a vector and a covector that's scaled by some number n, we can either scale the vector by n or scale the covector n, and we'll get the same result. So all three of these things here are the same linear map. And if we wanted to, we could rewrite these array multiplications as Kronecker products and rewrite these tensor products using the circle times symbol. It's basically all the same thing. Now let's consider addition. So let's say we have two column row array multiplications that are added together, where the column on the left is the same in both terms. Well, in this case, we can factor out the column and write things like this. Both of these will result in the same matrix. And likewise, if we have a sum of two tensor products where the tensor on the left is the same in both terms, we can just factor that out like this, and both of these would give the same linear map. Alternatively, if we have a sum like this, where the row is the same in both terms, we can factor out the row like this. And the same thing goes with the tensor product. We can factor out the tensor on the right to get this, and both of these would be the same linear map. Finally, with this case where we have two array terms that have nothing in common, there's basically no factoring we can do. So we could multiply all this out and do the addition to get a single array, but there's no way that we can take this expression and factor it into something simpler. And the same thing goes when we have a sum of tensor products. When the two terms have nothing in common, we can't simplify it at all. We just have to leave it as it is. And of course, we can rewrite the array multiplications as Kronecker products, and we can rewrite the tensor products with this circle times symbol notation. It's all the same thing. Okay, so what we've just done is we've come up with scaling and adding rules, and we can write them out either in this notation, which is the notation I use, or we can use the circle times notation that you'll find in textbooks. So basically what this scaling rule is saying is that when we have a bunch of tensors that are producted together like this, and we scale the entire collection of tensors by some number n, we can basically choose to move this n inside and scale any one of the tensors that we like. So we can choose A or B or C or D or E, but we can only choose to scale one of them. And if you wanted to use the notation with the circle times instead, we would write things like this. So we can move the n inside and scale any one of the five tensors that we like. And what the adding rules are saying is that when we have a sum of tensor products like this, whenever both terms have something in common on the left, we can factor it out. So in this case, we can factor out AB. And whenever both terms have something in common on the right, we can factor that out. So in this case, we can factor out DE. And if we were to write this using the circle times notation, we'd get this. So we can factor out A tensor B here, and then factor out D tensor E here, and that's the same thing. We just write it a little bit differently. Okay, so we've come up with scaling and adding rules, and hopefully you know what that means. If we can scale and we can add, that means that we have a vector space. So we know that these vectors V, W, E1, and E2, these vectors all live in the vector space capital V. And we also know that covectors like alpha, beta, epsilon 1, and epsilon 2, these all live in the vector space V star. Now we know that we can make vector-covector pairs like V alpha or V beta or W alpha and any of these other examples, and we can add them and scale them using these rules that we just talked about here. So that means that these must be vectors in a vector space. So what vector space do they live in? And the answer is, All of these live in the vector space V tensor V star. And you'll notice that we're using this circle time symbol here again. And this is actually a new use of the circle time symbol that we've never seen before. Because rather than combining vectors or tensors, we're combining vector spaces. So in total, we've come across three different uses of the circle time symbol. There's the Kronecker product, which combines two arrays into a new array. There's the tensor product of tensors, which combines two tensors into a new tensor. And now we have the tensor product of vector spaces, which combines two vector spaces into a new vector space. So the term tensor product can refer to two different things here. There's the tensor product of tensors, which I like to think of as the little tensor product because it combines individual tensors. But there's also the tensor product of vector spaces, which I like to think of as the big tensor product because it combines entire vector spaces together. All right, so we've discovered this new vector space by combining V and V star together, and the vectors in this vector space follow these scaling and adding rules up here. So we have this vector space V tensor V star. So what are the elements of this vector space? Well, the members of this vector space are 1-1 tensors, or basically vector-covector pairs and their linear combinations. So what can these tensors do? Well, remember that vector components are always going to have an upstairs index, while covector components are always going to have a downstairs index. So if we focus on these L coefficients here, if we do a summation with vector components like this over J, we end up with vector components as the output because we have one upstairs I index that's left. So vector in, vector out. In this case, L is acting as a map from V to V, or essentially a linear map. But we could also do a summation with covector components like this, and sum over I. And our output would have J as the downstairs index, so we would basically end up with covector components as the output. So covector in, covector out, this is a map from V star to V star. Also, we could provide L with both vector components and covector components, and we could do two summations over I and J, and that would give us a scalar as the output since there are no indexes left to sum over. So in this case, L can be viewed as a function from a pair of vectors and covectors to scalars. And finally, we could do the same thing, but reverse the order of the inputs, and in this case, L is a function from a covector-vector pair to scalars. So the elements of this vector space V tensor V star can be interpreted as any of these things, depending on the number and the type of inputs that we give it. So all of these are 1-1 tensors, and all of them are members of the vector space V tensor V star. So let's consider something else. We have these same old rules for the tensor product, but what if we use the tensor product to combine two covectors together? So covectors like alpha, beta, and the epsilons live in V star. So when we have covector-covector pairs like alpha, beta, or epsilon 1, epsilon 2, it turns out that they all live in the vector space V star tensor V star. So elements of V star tensor V star are 0, 2 tensors, which are covector-covector pairs and their linear combinations. And we know already if we take these B components and do two summations with two sets of vector components like this, then we end up with a scalar. And this, of course, is a bilinear form, which takes a pair of vectors and outputs a scalar. But we could also do a single summation over I with one set of vector components, and we'd be left with the index J downstairs, so the output would be a set of covector components. So in this case, B is a map from vectors to covectors, or a map from V to V star. Also, we could instead choose to do a summation with vector components over the J index, and then we'd end up with covector components with the I index on the bottom, and so this would be another map from V to V star, but it would be a different map than this one up here because we're doing the summation differently. So elements of V star tensor V star, which are 0-2 tensors, can be any of these things depending on the inputs that we give it. So really, the basic building block of all these vector spaces are the two vector spaces V and V star, and those contain tensors whose components are here. Remember, vector components have an upstairs index, and covector components have a downstairs index. And we can combine these two vector spaces into new vector spaces using the tensor product. And these vector spaces would have these components here, And again, recall that indexes from V go upstairs and indexes from V star go downstairs. And we can continue to make larger and larger vector spaces using the tensor product. And all these vector spaces contain tensors with components that have different combinations of upstairs and downstairs indexes, depending on whether they are constructed using V or V star. So if we have some new tensor from a vector space we've never seen before, we can easily get the correct component indexes just by looking at the vector spaces. So looking at these vector spaces, we see that the basis would be made up of a covector, a vector, a covector, and another covector in combination. And we get the components just by placing the indexes in the opposite position that we see in the basis, so that all the summations work out properly. And now we can ask, how can this tensor T act on other tensors? Well, we can basically do any summations we like, as long as the upstairs indexes are matched with downstairs indexes, and downstairs indexes are matched with upstairs indexes. So we could do something like this with four summations, and you can see all the indexes are positioned properly. Or we can do this, again with four summations, and again the indexes work out. Or here we could do three summations, and the three indexes involved are positioned correctly, and we'd be left with the index I in the output. Or we could do these two summations here where we have the indexes K and L in the output. So in the first example, T is acting like a function that takes a vector, covector, vector, and vector as inputs, and outputs a number, since all the indexes are summed over. Here, where we have components with three upper indexes, and remember, components with upper indexes mean vector components, so these tensor components are from a V tensor V tensor V vector space, and these are just covector components, so that's from V star, and again, we would output a scalar since all the coefficients are summed over. Here we have covector components, so that's from V star, and components with two upper indexes, so those components are from V tensor V. And since the lower I index isn't summed over, we're left with a covector, so that's an element from V star as the output. And here we have an input with one upper and one lower index, so those are components from a tensor from V tensor V star, and since the two lower indexes that remain, K and L, aren't summed over, we end up with an output from V star tensor V star. So we have all these functions here, and I'm sure you could come up with even more examples of what T could do. But what do all these functions have in common? Well, let's take a look at this function here. It has four inputs, and we're going to take all the inputs except one and make them constant, so it's like they're fixed in stone and they'll never change. Notice that if we scale the input W, we can just bring the scaling coefficient outside, so basically we can either scale the input before or scale the output after. And also, if we replace these input vector components with a sum of two sets of vector components, I can just distribute these out and get this sum here. So basically, I can add the inputs or I can add the outputs. And the same thing goes for this example here. If I freeze all the inputs except one in stone, I can scale the remaining input before or scale the output after. Also, I could choose to either add inputs or add outputs. So basically, with all these maps are linear if I choose to hold all inputs constant except one. And there's a word for that. We call functions that behave in this way multilinear maps. So a multilinear map is a function that is linear when all inputs except one are held constant. So in other words, a multilinear map is a function that's going to obey these two properties here. So this first property says that when all inputs except one are held constant, if we scale the input variable, that's the same thing as scaling the output of the function. And this second property here, when we hold all inputs except one constant, when we do a sum in this input slot, that's the same thing as doing a sum of these two outputs here. So we can add these two inputs, or we can add these two outputs separately and get the same answer. And just to be clear, these properties need to be true for all the input slots. So it doesn't matter which inputs we hold as constant and which input we allow to vary. These properties have to be true for all inputs. Another way of saying that is that multilinear functions are linear in each input variable. So saying that tensors are multilinear maps, we're just saying that tensors, when they're used as functions, they obey these two multilinearity properties here. So to summarize what we learned in this video, we learned the formal definition of the tensor product, which was a way of combining tensors that obeys these scaling and adding rules. We also learned that the tensors we get from the tensor product form new vector spaces, which are denoted using the tensor product of vector spaces, like this. And finally, we learned that all tensors are multilinear maps, which means that they are functions that take some number of inputs, and they are linear in each input variable, while all other inputs are held constant.